Now, in this lecture, I am going to discuss curvilinear motion with normal and tangential components. So, in the previous lesson, we have considered the curvilinear motion considering the x and y coordinate system. So, now sometimes it is convenient that whenever a particle is moving in a curvilinear path, so it is convenient to analyze the motion of this particle by using the normal and tangential components. Right, or we can say that we consider the normal and tangential axes, right? So what we do is that we define two axes which are perpendicular to each other, and the direction of the t axis is always tangent to the path at that particular instant, and the direction of the normal axis is always perpendicular to t axis, and the direction of this normal axis will always be acting towards the center of the circle which is formed by the portion of this path, right, at that particular instant. So what we do is that we define this tangential t-axis and then we define this normal axis, right, and this ut and this un, these are the unit vectors which are acting along the t-axis and the normal axis, right. So let's say that if we consider the particle shown in this figure 1224a, which moves in a plane along a fixed curve, right? So this path is moving in a plane about this fixed curve, right? So let's consider that the plane of the motion is the screen, is this screen in which this PDF is open, right? So such that it's at a given instant it is at position S. So let's say that this is the starting position of this particle, and at a particular instant the position of this particle is at a distance S from this origin, right, so at this initial position. So now in this we will consider these two coordinate systems, this t and n, right, and the t axis is tangent to the curve at that particular point and is positive in the direction of increasing s, right. So if this is the initial position and if this is the increasing s direction, right, so in when this particle is traveling in this direction, so we say that s is increasing, right? So when the t axis is direction, the ut axis, this unit vector which is parallel to this t axis, so its direction will be considered as positive in the direction of increasing s. And in this direction, if the particle is moving in this direction, so in this direction the s will decrease, so then that will be the negative direction of this t axis, right? So this is the positive direction. In this direction, in the direction in which s is increasing, so that will be plus t direction, right? And a unique choice for the normal axis can be made by noting the geometrically the curve is constructed from a series of differential arc, right? So now to define the direction of the normal axis, is what we do is that at a particular instant we can say that this path of the particle is constructed by considering several many circles, right? So we can say that this particle is constructed from a differential parts of an instantaneous circles, right? So let's say that when the particle is somewhere here, right, so this particular part of this path can be the part of this red circle, right, and this, let's say this ds could be the part of this green circle, and somewhere this ds could be the part of this blue circle, right? So then let's say if the particle is somewhere here, let's say if the particle is here, so then, and if let's say that this is the initial position of this particle, so in this direction the position of the particle is increasing, right? So then we can define that this will be the t axis direction, and at this particular instant, since this ds can be considered as the part of this red circle, so then that normal axis will be acting towards the center of this instantaneous circle, right, and that normal axis will be tangent to this t axis, right? So at this particular instant the normal axis direction will be towards the center of this red circle, and this center is called the center of curvature, right? So this is this ds is made up of a curvature, right, and this ds is a part of this red circle. So then we say that at this particular instant this normal axis will be acting towards the center of the curvature, right, and we can associate another terminology with this red circle, and that is called the radius of this circle, and the radius of this circle for this particular instant will be known as, let's say, the radius of curvature, right? So now we have two terminologies, each segment ds is formed from the arc of an associated circle, right? So this ds is from formed from an arc which is a part of this red circle, right? And that red circle will have radius of curvature, that is rho, will be represented by rho, and the center of the curvature, right? So the normal axis n is always perpendicular to the t axis, and with its positive sense directed towards the center of the curvature. So at this particular instant, if the center of the curvature is towards this side, so then normal axis will be positive in this direction. And if let's say if the particle at this instant, after some time t, is at this instant located here, so then if the center of the curvature is towards this side of the circle, so then the positive normal will be towards this side, right? So this will be at this particular instant, this will be the t axis direction, and this will be the normal axis direction, right? So the normal axis direction depends on the location of the instantaneous center of curvature, right? And center of curvature will be defined by drawing a circle at that particular point, at that particular position of that particle, right? So now if you want to define the velocity for this particular particle, so if this particle is traveling along this path and its position is changing, right? So then we can say that the particle is having velocity, right? And that velocity will be ds by dt if we know the s of t function, right? So we can say that this v is equal to s dot, right? And as we have learned in the previous lecture, that the whenever the particle is moving in a curvilinear path, so the direction of the velocity will always be tangential to the path of the particle, right? So now if we define a vector velocity vector, so then velocity vector will be equal to the velocity magnitude, which is s dot, and the direction of the velocity will be towards the tangential axis, right? So towards the tangential axis means that its unit vector will be considered as ut. So ut is the unit vector which is acting, which is towards the t axis, right? So this is we can write that the velocity vector is this v magnitude times ut. This is the unit vector, right? Or we can write that this is s dot ut cape, right? So now if we want to find the acceleration of this particle, of this particle, right? So let's say that this is the velocity vector. So velocity vector is v ut, right? So to find the acceleration of this particle, if this particle is moving in a curvilinear path, so if you want to find the acceleration, so we have to take the time derivative of this velocity. So acceleration will be equal to dv by dt, right? So if we want to take the derivative of this, so then this will be d by dt v ut. So as we can see that if initially the particle is here and then after some time t the particle is located here, so as we can see that the acceleration can be caused both due to the change in the magnitude of the velocity or the change in the direction of the velocity, right? So the acceleration can be caused due to two reasons. One is due to the change in the magnitude of the velocity, or due to the change in the direction of the velocity, right? So this means that the velocity magnitude and the direction both are the function of time, right? So with time, after some time interval, it is possible that the velocity of the particle, the velocity magnitude of the particle can change, or the direction of the particle can change, or both can change. So the change in either of these will accelerate the particle, right? So this means that we have to take the product, when we want to find the derivative of this product, so we have to apply the product rule, since both are changing with time, right? So neither v is constant, neither ut is constant, right? So if we want to take the derivative, so we have to consider both of these as a function of time, right? So if I take the derivative, so then this will be, if I write ut, so I have to take the derivative of v, so this will be v dot ut, and then this will be v, and then we have to take the ut derivative, so then this will be ut dot. So this is the acceleration equation, right? So this v dot is again ds by dt, or this is s dot. Ut is the unit vector which is acting along the t axis, Now, if you want to find this ut dot is the change in the direction of the unit vector ut. So, let's say that initially this is ut, and after some time t, when this particle has traveled this ds distance and that time interval, and let's say that initially this was the radius of the curvature, and then after some time t, this is the radius of the curvature. So, this particle has traveled some theta as well, right? So, let's say that that theta is d theta. So, this is ut, this is initial velocity direction, and then this is the final velocity direction, right? So, if you want to find this change in the velocity, so then what we have to do is that we have to find this change by using the head to tail rule, right? So, the change in this ut will be equal to dut. So, the change in ut will be equal to the final ut vector minus the initial ut vector, right? So, to find this change, we can use the head to tail rule, right? So, by head to tail rule, what we need to do is that we have to reverse the ut direction, and then we have to add them by using the head to tail rule, right? So, if this is my ut dash direction, so if I draw it here, let's say if this is our ut dash, this is the final direction of the unit vector ut. So, the initial direction is this. So, let's say that if I reverse the direction, let's say if this is the initial ut vector, so then by head to tail rule, this will be dut vector. So, this will be dut vector, right? And this dut will be perpendicular to this ut vector, right? So, as we can see that the normal axis or un axis is always perpendicular to this ut, right? So, then this means that this ut will be acting in the direction of this ut will be in the normal direction, right? So, this will be in the normal direction, and we can say that dut vector direction is along the n axis, right? So, now we can find this, and let's say if this is d theta, right? So, as we can see that this ut dash is perpendicular to this radius, and this ut is perpendicular to this radius of curvature, and the angle between these two radius of curvature is d theta. So, this means that if both of these unit vectors are perpendicular to these two radiuses, so if we join the tails of both of these vectors, so then the angle between these two will also be this angle, this d theta, right? So, this dut can be found by using this method, or we can write this equation like this as well. So, we can write that ut dash will be equal to ut plus dut, right? So, if we want to find ut dash by using the head to tail rule, so then ut dash will be equal to ut vector plus dut, and by head to tail rule they should give us the final direction of the velocity, that is ut dash, right? So, ut is the direction of the velocity, right? So, this is ut dash. So, this means that this ut and this ut dash, since the magnitude of both of these is same, and the magnitude of both of these unit vector is 1, right? So, dut is the change in the direction of velocity. Now, if we consider this triangle as a part of a circle, right? So, if this triangle is a part of a circle, right? If I draw a circle, right? So, we can apply this formula. This is S is equal to r theta, right? We want to find this ut dot, right? So, from this triangle, we can see that this dut is equal to this s, right? So, we can say that this is dut and this r, since the magnitude of this ut, this unit vector is 1, right? So, since we can say that this is the radius of this circle at this particular instant, right? So, this means that the radius of that circle is 1, and this theta is this d theta, right? So, we can write that this is d theta, right? And as we can see that this dut, the direction of this ut is parallel to this un vector, right? So, we can say that this dut is acting in the n direction, right? So, at each instant, the change in the direction of the velocity will be acting in the direction of the un vector, right? So, this means that dut, the change in the ut vector will always be acting along the normal axis, right? So, this means that dut will be acting along the normal axes. So we can say that dut is equal to d theta, and we want to represent this dut as a vector. So then this dut will be equal, this is the magnitude, so then this is d theta, and this will be acting along the unit vector n, right? So this is the direction of this dut. And now if we take the derivative of this, if I divide both sides of this equation by dt, so then this means that this is ut dot, and this will be theta dot and un, right? So this means that ut dot will be equal to theta dot times un, right? So now we can put this ut dot in this equation, right? So this is a, which is v dot ut plus v, and ut is theta dot un. And now if you want to find this theta dot, right? So what is this theta dot? Now, so now if we consider this triangle, right? So now if we consider this triangle, and again if we apply this formula, this is s is equal to r theta. So now in this triangle, s is equal to ds, and a radius is, this radius is equal to this rho, which is the radius of this curvature, right? So I can write that this is rho, and this theta is d theta, right? So now if I divide both sides of this equation by dt, so this is s dot, and this is rho, and this is theta dot. So this means that theta dot is s dot divided by rho, or we can say that s dot is velocity divided by rho. So now if I substitute this theta dot in this equation, right, so this will be acceleration, which is equal to v dot ut plus v, and theta dot is v divided by rho un. This is acceleration. This is acceleration vector, remember, right? So this is acceleration, and this is v dot ut plus this is v square divided by rho un, right? So now as we can see that this acceleration, the acceleration of a particle when it is moving in a curvilinear path, has two components. One is the tangential component and one is the normal component, right? So this is the tangential component of this acceleration. So if we write that this is the tangential component will be equal to v dot ut, and the normal component of the acceleration will be equal to an, and whose magnitude is v square divided by rho, and this is un unit vector. So now we can say that the acceleration is equal to at ut plus an un, right? So this is that acceleration equation, right? So now let's say that if at this particular instant, if this is the at component of the acceleration, if this is an component of acceleration, right? So if we add both of these components by head to tail rule, so then this will be the acceleration, right? So this will be the resultant acceleration due to these two, right? And if you want to find the magnitude of this acceleration, so then since these are the rectangular component of this acceleration, so the magnitude of acceleration will be equal to at square plus an square and under the root 2, right? So this will give us the magnitude of the acceleration. Now to understand these two components of acceleration, one is at, so at is v dot magnitude, and an is v square divided by rho. So now if we consider two special cases, let's say if a particle is moving along a straight line, so if a particle is moving in a straight line, so this means that we can say that this straight path can be a part of a quite large circle, right? So we can consider that this straight line, this straight path could be a part of a circle which is having a radius of infinity, right? So let's say that the radius tends to infinity, so then the path can be considered as a straight line, right? So if a circle is quite large, so if we are moving on the circumference of that circle, so that circumference will look like a straight line, right? So when a particle is moving on a straight line, so then we can say that the radius of curvature is infinity, right? So if the radius of curvature is infinity, so this means that if we put if you want to find the normal component of the acceleration, so then if we put infinity in this equation, so then this will be v square divided by infinity, and anything divided by infinity is always equal to zero, right? So this means that whenever a particle is moving on a straight line, So then the normal component of the acceleration will always be equal to zero, right? And the only the tangential component of acceleration will remain, right? And since the when the particle is moving in a straight line, so then the velocity direction is not changing, right? So this means that the particle is accelerating only due to the change in the magnitude of the velocity, right? So now in this particular case, we say that the only the acceleration, if you want to find the magnitude of the acceleration, so the acceleration will be due to only the tangential acceleration, and that will be v dot when the particle is moving in a straight line. So this acceleration is only due to the change in the velocity magnitude, right? When the particle is moving in a straight line, right? So this means that the tangential component of acceleration when the particle is moving in a curvilinear path, so this tangential component of the acceleration will always tell us the change in the magnitude of the velocity, right? So this tangential acceleration, this tangential component of the acceleration will be due to the change in the magnitude of the velocity. You people should remember this, right? And now if we consider another particle which is moving in a circular path, which is moving in a circle of fixed radius, let's say, and that radius, let's say, rho, and that particle is moving with, let's say, constant velocity, right? So the magnitude of the velocity is not changing, right? So if the magnitude of the velocity is constant, so then we can say that at is v dot. And if the velocity magnitude is not changing, so then there will be the tangential acceleration will be zero, right? Since I have told you people that tangential acceleration will be due to the change in the velocity magnitude. And if the velocity magnitude is not changing, so then this means that this particle tangential acceleration will be zero, right? And the normal acceleration will be v square divided by rho. And if it is moving, if the path of this particle is along a fixed circle, so then the radius will remain constant, right? So then this normal component of the acceleration will remain constant, right? Since the velocity magnitude is not changing. So now as we can see that when the particle is only moving in a circular path, so the acceleration is due to the change in the direction of the velocity, right? So this means that the normal component of the acceleration is caused due to the change in the velocity direction, right? And the tangential component of the acceleration while the particle is moving in a curvilinear path is due to the change in the velocity magnitude, right? So remember this. And now when we consider the particle motion along a circular path, so as we can see that this is centripetal acceleration, this normal component of the acceleration is then known as centripetal acceleration. Centripetal acceleration means that acceleration which is always acting towards the center, right? So center seeking acceleration, right? So centripetal acceleration is sometimes called center seeking acceleration. Why it is called center seeking acceleration? Since this acceleration is equal to this an, and the direction of this an is always acting towards the center of the circle, right? So this is centripetal acceleration. So if we conclude this lecture, so this lecture, in the conclusion of this lecture, we can say that the tangential acceleration will be due to the change in the velocity magnitude, and the normal component of the acceleration will tell us the change in the magnitude of the velocity. At will tell us the change in the magnitude of the velocity, and an will tell us the change in the direction of the velocity. So I hope you people would have understood this normal and tangential components of acceleration while considering the curvilinear motion.